EU has approached 15 Russian countries in the following way. There were certain set of criteria divided into political and economic. The political criteria has been said to be a precondition for starting negotiations with EU candidate countries. So basically there was an assessment on behalf of the Commission at a certain point, which was stating to what extent your country is covering the political, meeting the political criteria regarding rule of law, integration of minorities, functioning democratic institutions. And once you have to a certain extent a positive, quite satisfactory report from the Commission, then the country was invited to start negotiations, and the negotiations themselves were pretty technical. They were called negotiations, but basically they were following a certain very strict pattern of behavior. They were following the acquis communautaire. You know what the acquis communautaire is? Those are the European norms in those spheres where there is common European policies. The chapter, the negotiation chapters were structured this way, and there was this process of opening and closing the chapters, which was to a certain extent pretty technical, because to be honest, it mainly referred to doing copy and paste in your legislation from the common European policies. So from that perspective, I have to make this note. It was in a way that the political criteria for membership, they were assessed mainly at the very beginning of the process, before even starting negotiations. And then there was not much attention paid to whether you sustain those criteria or not, because the European Union has been created and is still mainly an economic union. So you have to understand that even with regard to the media law in Hungary, the European Union does not have obligatory norms concerning, for example, freedom of expression. It's much more interested in the free circulation of audiovisual products. It's there where you have the set of criteria. If you want to defend your media independence, you should go to the Council of Europe. They have some recommendations with this effect. European Union norm. So this is a very important distinction. And this is one of the lessons learned. Whether for the future enlargements, basically, you have to have taken the political criteria for granted from the very beginning. Because this proved to be a problematic in the case of Bulgaria and to a certain extent to the other member states. So, what was the picture that we had after the accession? What we saw was that there was a whole set of reforms that were inaccomplished. And they were the reforms, especially in the so-called human development domain, the reforms which concerned the daily life of the citizens the most. Those were the reforms in education, the health system, and the social protection system and the pensions. Of course, the condition of those reforms in the different countries was different, to a different extent. But this is a common characteristic for all the member states from Central and Eastern Europe, because of the very basic reason, there are no acquis communautaire in those areas. This is part of the transition agenda of the countries. This agenda that the countries did not manage to accomplish quite well because they started negotiations with the European Union. They just changed the focus of their attention to the preconditions and the conditionality of the European Union, which consists mainly the area where there are acquis communautaire, not those. And those, by the way, remain relatively neglected because of this reason. And we found out this when we entered the European Union, that there are reforms that are largely inaccomplished and which has a very big impact on the development of the society. So there was another like misleading, how to say, perception that our countries themselves had at the beginning of the negotiations, that the pre-accession agenda will be a natural continuation of the transition agenda. No, it's not. Those are different agendas. You have to keep this in mind. And the accomplishment of those reforms depends only on the national decision-making, but on the capacity of the national decision-makers, but on the capacity also of the civil society sector, mediators on the national level, to push and to advocate for their accomplishment. those are part of the reason that I also already shared. What happened after the accession? There was, of course, an expectation that now, once we are in the European Union, we will accomplish finally those reforms. Basically, it didn't happen because of a very simple reason. There was a political consensus before the accession among all political actors, what we did, which was Euro-Atlantic integration. After the accession, what we witnessed is that this political consensus in a way collapsed. And we saw a picture of a very big fragmentation of the political spectrum. New political parties appear, coalition governments with very short political lifespan, unable to commit to whatever long-term reforms. And those reforms are long-term. They require a consistent vision for reforms and consistent commitment on behalf of all political actors. Having the coalition government for a year and a half makes it impossible to accomplish those long-term reforms. On the top of everything, you have also some players which are opposing the reforms, those that feel very comfortable within the status quo in the reform areas. So it's a big struggle, and it's still continuing in all new member states. Needless to say, the impact is not possible or positive from this. It deepens the marginalization of a certain groups of society. It diminishes the low citizens' trust in the political establishments because people suffer from the uninformed care system, from the lack of reform of the educational system, for lack of guarantees of a stable pension system. So what they do is that they're even more willing to punish the political establishment on the next election. And it causes the already fragile political system to become increasingly vulnerable, which in a way creates a catch-22 to a certain extent. So, here the conclusion is, watch out for these reforms. On the path or not on the path to EU, this is what matters for the citizens. And in Bulgaria, what we are witnessing now is a new wave of brain drain because of this. It's not because Bulgarians cannot make money at home. They can. They can gain good economic status. But the quality of life is not good, just because the unreformed areas. So most of the people that have the abilities and the capabilities to work abroad would prefer to go to another EU member state and to earn even less for the sake of having this package, a better package. Now we move to the EU financial assistance. Here, just a couple of words for the context. You have to be aware of the fact that at the beginning of the transition, it was not the EU. The EU was not by far the only player that shaped the profile of the civil society sector in Bulgaria. Actually, at the beginning of the transition, there was a massive foreign donor support in terms of both funding and technical assistance that created the civil society following a top-down manner. And it was so because we were at the beginning of a painful transition. It was clear that we need to do each and every reform and each and every sphere, from economy based on market terms to democracy and functioning institutions. So the foreign players that had the knowledge and the means to support the process, and here I'm referring not only to private American donors, but to the USAID role, to the World Bank role, and EU later, they joined the club. So they were all interested to have an ally in the country itself. And they were looking for those allies in the civil society sector. So after a while, we had this top-down created civil society sector that attracted intellectuals from the university and people with progressive thinking that were reform-oriented. All the NGOs that sustained, they were created in order to pursue and to press for reforms, and also to bring the knowledge and the know-how from outside to help people things. But you have to be aware that this was not a genuine process. It was not a bottom-up process. And there was a huge gap, to be honest, between the agenda of those reformist NGOs and the citizens themselves, which development in those fields was much slower. It was a normal process, because if we waited for the genuine process bottom-up to create those reformist NGOs, we would have waited for ages, and nobody wanted this. So this was the only way to do things at the beginning of the transition, but it came at a certain price that we'll see later on. So, we have an NGO with reformistic agendas, and then at some point we do steps in. Unlike the support that you have, even from USAID, but also from American private donors, the EU financial support comes as a reward to the governments for good performance. It goes through the framework of the state administration, and in that way it dramatically changes the status quo of the powers within society. Because providing money, big money, and providing opportunity for the state administration to distribute the money is giving much influence in the chance of a state administration versus the civil society and the other stakeholders. So it changes the status quo of the power relations, and you will see how it worked in Bulgaria now. It didn't work well. It didn't work well because providing the opportunity for the state administration to distribute and to decide and to monopolize the decision-making process means that you are testing its maturity, its democratic maturity. And in Bulgaria, it proved that the state administration, but the civil society as well, are still immature. Because, again, democracy, political processes, and political stability shouldn't be taken for granted. And you have to invest to sustain what we have achieved on a daily basis. It was in a little overestimated with regard to the European funding. So, basically, it was a highly politicized process. It was monopolized by the executive power. There was a lack of transparency. What the politicians and the political parties did was they simply used EU funds in order to create quasi NGOs, to give the funds to them and to use them for political purposes, especially on the local level. It has a negative, very negative impact on the development of the profile of the civil society at home, because first, after the support from the EU, the number of the NGOs in Bulgaria was tripled in terms of registration. Logically, citizens, which were already disconnected to a certain extent from the NGOs, just deepened their mistrust. NGOs have limited capacity to influence decision making, and now they are in a search of a new identity. They realize that if they want to do a good job, they have to reconnect with citizens and to gain a new mandate for action. You have in my paper some figures that indicate what are indicate those conclusions. And last slide, the lessons learned. This is very important. Having a very strict outside goal, which is Euro-Atlantic integration, is a good thing because it predetermines where you go. But it also predetermines to a large extent your internal agenda. And from that perspective, it deprives the political parties to develop this capacity of developing genuine platforms for which to compete with for the attention of the citizens and who want to communicate with them. So at the end, you end up with political parties that are kind of monsters, and under the normal times, they are simply not capable of developing policy options and communicating with citizens. I have already